So the works themselves, why are we doing them? Just to refresh your memories on what we've been doing. The major benefits, we've been increasing the capacity of the station to provide longer platforms, increased number of platforms, wider platforms so we can take a greater volume of passengers. And in fact, we can create a much greater capacity for increased services, which includes the additional three services per hour into the station. So it's a huge undertaking that we've done. And this has all been done in the confines of a Grade 2 listed station. The cuttings, as you know, are very, very confined. It's a very complex engineering undertaking. So it's a great pleasure to say that it's successfully being delivered today on time. So what have we got remaining? Well, the remaining works that we've got to do, and this is slightly out of date because we've got additional works just to conclude platforms 1 and 2. These were always planned to be outside of the major engineering access blocks. In effect, these are not obviously overrun. These have been undertaken and concluded on Sunday, the 14th of October. We've already completed the first phase, which was on Sunday last week, in the 29-hour possession. And that work was successfully completed. And also, October 14th was moved from the 7th of October, just so that we could take into account the announcement of the Giants weekend. So we have taken consideration of major events, key stakeholders along the way, including yourselves. So again, transportation plan. I mean, the key of the transportation plan was to keep passengers moving as much as possible throughout what was quite a disruptive engineering access. Passengers have largely been very positive in terms of the key transportation plans. When developing these transportation plans, we've had an industry-wide consultation and collaboration with all the transport operating companies, train operating companies, yourselves, big key inputs into this. And industry-wide perspective, it's been a real success. Liverpool South Parkway was integral to the success of this, where we're using rail-to-rail services, stopping services there and transporting them to the Merseytravel network, which worked really, really well. And that was supported by the excellent bus offerings that we included in that. And I think it's been used as a real positive throughout the industry and a real lesson learned that we can use for other projects, because it's been a real success. Integral to the planning was obviously to get buy-in from all major local situation stakeholders and businesses. And we've planned the works significantly around any major events, and that's worked really, really well. Noise and potential disturbance, we've had very little in terms of feedback from that, so that's always a positive around Mark Street, and that's been great. And from a communications perspective, the communications plans have been excellent. They've been an industry collaboration, so all the train operating companies have been on message, they've used the same formats, the same messaging. I think we've got that message out on all media platforms really well. So that's a real positive. So just to summarise, it's been a very busy period in the Liverpool region. Lime Street is just a chunk of the £340 million that's been invested in the Great North Rail project. And that's a multi-billion pound industry investment transforming rail across the north. But in the city region, some of the notable key milestones over the last 6 months, we've got the north. A new station was built in 9 months, which was great. Opened on Monday, the 18th of June, so a local growth funding scheme. We've got new Sydney Willows Interchange, which is opening in the autumn. We've had a new subway that's been built, which you can see in the picture in the middle at the top, which is a bespoke horizontal piling method which we've used, which has allowed us to construct whilst not disrupting the railway and that's really been a great help to passengers. And that's due to open in the autumn. On the right hand side, we've got Weaver Junction, and that's a resignalling of a 22 mile stretch of the Weaver Junction to Wavertree Junction and West Coast Main Lines. And the first major phase of three phases of that was completed in early May. Bank Holiday successfully and on time, where halts and a run called signalling was recontrolled up to Manchester Rock. Critical to that, that was fully integrated with local growth fund scheme of the Halton Cord. The Halton Cord was delivered alongside it, integral with signalling, and we got several million pounds of efficiency from delivering it that way. And that enabled the Halton Cord to be concluded bang on time and under budget in May. So that's open and ready to take new services into Liverpool and Liverpool way to Chester. So that's a great success. So, just giving you a quick overview of what we've been doing. Pat and I are here for a little while longer now to take some questions.
Excellent, thanks for that, Jens. I'm sure there'll be quite a few bits on those bits and other bits. I've seen Gordon and then Norm, then Anthony. Can you keep your hands up for now?
Thank you, Chair. If I can take the liberty of asking two questions, please. The first one being is that, as you'd be well aware of, our new rolling stock. There's a lot of work and investment going into that. Some of the risk to me used to be that whilst you've delivered, and I'll congratulate you for the schemes also with the Will Loop line as well, was very good, that some of the constraints and challenges we may face may come from you not being delivering those particular elements of work on time. So can I have an assurance that we can meet those times? And would you like me to ask the second question or wait till you've answered it? Fine.
Fine away.
The second one is very generic for us, because you had in your slide about the Mogul North, and part of the issue for us was the way that the prices are constructed by yourself. You are out for 5% under the quoted fee and 20% over, but we're a captive customer. And we think, well, better stop using the Royal We. I'll make this my point. I think it's all in your favour and against really what is an equitable way of funding something. So is that something you think in the industry it needs to be looked at in a more deliverable way? Because once you do quote and you go for bids in funding, if you're given a price to the people you're going from a growth front bids or something like that, if you're suddenly 20% over, it's out of kilter with what possibly the decision takers would want to see go for a scheme, and I think it could jeopardise those elements. Thanks, but well done. I don't want to sound too negative. It really was well done on the Lime Street station.
Okay, well, thank you. Let me answer those questions one at a time. So I think starting with the work that we're going to do to facilitate the introduction of the new rolling stock, which we are hugely pleased to be involved in and engaged in, and both Marcus and I have been over to Switzerland to see the manufacturing facility, so we're quite close to that project. I think the question is about certainty on cost and programme. And somebody who's delivered projects for a career, then those are clearly the two things that drive pretty much everything we do. How much certainty can I give you? I can give you a lot of certainty in terms of the way we've tackled the development of those projects. So, it is always good to work with a client that knows what they want, and I can very much say that about Merseytravel. It's also good to work with a client that gives you plenty of notice and opportunity to understand the risks, challenges and opportunities that you've got when you build a project. And I think with all the pieces of work that we do to support the rolling stock, we have a pretty good handle on that. Can I give you absolute certainty? I can certainly give you a document that says we've been through this tooth and nail together as a team with yourselves, and we've got a good percentage chance of delivering this to programme and to budget. But if I did that, I'd be missing an opportunity like Golden Curve that came in several £1 million under budget, but I'd probably be missing the other side of the coin, which is the likes of Ugly Willows, which has gone the other way. But that's the life of somebody that delivers projects, so you can be assured that we will do our level best to work transparently with you, engage you in how we build the project, how price, have we done the schedule, and have you managed those risks? I'll give you absolute certainty and assurance that you'll be engaged in that and you will see it coming. None of us want surprises on projects. I think that brings us to the second part of the question, which is again around certainty and funder certainty. Part of what I do, actually, strangely, isn't the building of projects and the bricks and mortar. It's the investment side of the Network Rail. So I manage a portfolio of projects and programmes, and I am very much aware of the need to live within our means. I have probably the luxury of being able to deal with a larger portfolio than maybe you are yourselves, but that doesn't mean that the challenges are any less. So in terms of certainty, we've clearly worked closely with all of your colleagues here to give you the best certainty we can from the market. So the way we procure the work, the way we contract the work. Interestingly, we Network Rail don't take a profit out of this. We deliver this only for our own costs. And again, we're quite transparent about the time that we invest into the projects, the people that we put on the projects, and what we charge any external funder. So the Office of Rail Regulation, or Office of Road and Rail as they now are very clear and have very clear guidelines on how we can bill our time to projects. As I say, we don't make a profit, there isn't an upside for us. But we do try to balance the risk at a portfolio level across the industry. So I think you're probably alluding to the fact we have risk and fee funds where we levy a percentage of all of the projects that we deliver for third parties and external funders. The reason we do that is actually it's an insurance policy, such that if things don't go the way we had planned despite best endeavours, that there's a mechanism for us to go back and potentially take funding from a central pot. That pot is regulated again by the Office of Road and Rail. It's not Network Rail's money, the money just doesn't come to us and we transfer it. It sits there and it's very much in the industry and a stakeholders fee and risk fund. So that's what it's there for. We could do the projects without drawing on that, but the risk would always sit with the client. That's a given, I suppose. So that's why we do that. The money certainly doesn't lie in our pockets. As I say, we are strictly governed by the regulator in terms of what we can charge third parties for the delivery of projects, and these projects are no exception.
All of our studies are indicating a number of capacity challenges at Liverpool Central, both on track, on the platforms and concourse, due to the significant Foulkes growth in rail use going through the station, as Liverpool Central is one of the busiest stations in the country. We believe that it isn't just a vital issue for our city region, but also a nationally significant issue. As station owner, what is Network Rail doing in order to look to significantly invest in Liverpool Central so that these capacity enhancements can be delivered on time? And could I just ask another question, please, Chair?
Of course you can.
What we're seeing is large amounts of detritus on the line. Particularly, I've noticed it from Kirby to Central, but I should imagine it's like that across the rest of the network. What would Network Rail be doing about it? Are there any plans for a deep clean of the line to address this? And would it be monitored and regularly addressed?
Well, thank you for your questions. Again, I'll answer those in order if I can. So, Liverpool Central, absolutely, I hear everything you say about capacity challenges there. It's a station personally I'm very familiar with. I sort of see it firsthand. It is a busier station than Lime Street in its peak at points, and I get firsthand the challenges that we collectively face managing capacity at Central, particularly as we move into the realms of the new rolling stock. That will allow us to move more people around the network, but we've got to get them to the trains, particularly at Central. So I'm absolutely where I think probably everybody else is in this room, a fairly significant intervention is likely to be needed there. We are currently doing a piece of capacity work, a capacity study. Numerous have been done before, but this is a room branch piece of work that will tell us, or give us some options around exactly what we need to do collectively as an industry, as central, to give us that capacity as we go into the future. The outcomes and the outputs of that piece of work are due later this year. Once we've got those in front of us, then you will be the first people that we will want to share that with us, as the key local stakeholders. So I guess the other thing to say is I'm well aware of the other potential very much like pieces of work that are happening with the Auger developments down in Central. I met with the developers Auger a couple of weeks back and had a really positive meeting. One thing I would say is that I think everybody understands where you're coming from, the question you've asked around capacity. And I think there's a real will and a need to sort this out. I was really encouraged by the feedback that I had from Auger and what they need to do. If we get this right, we could find ourselves delivering a capacity solution at Central, which draws in public and private finance in the right place, and that would be a great thing, I think, for us to do, and I can't think of a better place to do it. So Network Rail's got quite a bit of work to do around that capacity study over the next couple of months. That's been a work in progress, but also we've got to make some key decisions about how we unlock assets that we own and manage around Central, including the maintenance depot, that really, I think, the first steps on the ladder to sort of getting towards a scheme that works for everybody at Central. But what I would say is we absolutely understand the need, and I think there's a great opportunity, frankly, to do something there. In answer to your second question about lizard detritus on the line, if I may, I'll take that question away because it sounds to me like something needs to be done. So if a deep clean isn't planned and it sounds like it needs one, I'll put that to our local maintenance team, and if I may, I'll speak to the chairman or secretary, I'll get the details and I'll come back to you. But we'll investigate that, and if it needs sorting, it will be. And yes, we have a mandate and we are responsible for making sure that the tracks on the line side are clear. We can understand that in certain areas that can be a big piece of work and a never-ending piece of work, but we'll have a look at that specifically for you.
Mark, stations closed.
Sorry?
Stations, some of the stations are going to be closed, aren't they?
Yeah. So there's an
opportunity there. But would it be done on monitored on a regular basis?
It would be, and it is. I guess my point is there's a lot of this, there are a lot of areas, and it takes a heck of a resource to keep on top of it. But I thank you for raising it. We'll have a look at it, and I'll come back to you with some more specifics. But if it needs to, it'll get done, rest assured.
Okay, I've got Anthony next, and I've got Tony, Steve, Jerry, and Keith. Are there any other people from Natalie? Okay, that's it.
Thank you, Chair. I was just wondering if you supported the call for the branded lines in Liverpool in relation to giving access to the city region to NHS 2 and other powers, rail to Manchester.
Okay, we support any growth to the network, frankly. We've been asked to support Transport for the North and Rail North as they look at that in NHS 2. I was asked a very similar question recently by a journalist in front of a television camera. Asking about the opening live streets, and my point there was we're doing nothing to preclude what you talked about, HS2 coming to Liverpool, and by virtue of that, then absolutely we can support where we were asked to.
Sally? Thanks, Chair. Thanks for the update, Mick, on the live street. I'm sure the people have heard you say, I appreciate the work completed. My concerns about you've done a fantastic job on Gone North, so all that's a plan. You've done what you said, you've done what I said. However, the residents there, the neighbours, had some pretty horrific times with contractors that you employed, and there wasn't really the contact with the residents. this is what we'd like to see as residents, so as we work together to get it right. As there's a programme of works coming up for all the stations or platform renewals and so on and so forth, how will you change that with the residents that live outside all these stations that you're going to be working at, or your contractors are going to be working at, to make sure that, you know, it goes as smoothly as possible, so that we don't get it in the net saying your contractors have been a little bit uncomfortable
with that. Well, thank you for that. A very pertinent question and a very helpful one. I think firstly, in terms of lesson learned, that it's important that we learn those lessons, that we have more effective dialogue with our neighbours, particularly as we embark on a programme of works across the Merseyrail and Merseytravel station network, dealing with the platforms and other things that we need to do for preparation for the new Boeing stop. Could we have got it better there? Well, then clearly we could, because we had some unhappy neighbours. Our challenge, as ever, on the railway is we regrettably have to do our work when everybody's in bed. I suspect that'll probably never change. We have to run the network during the day, and we will bring certain disruption at certain times of the day, and that's regrettable. I think I would say we do genuinely try to mitigate that, but clearly we didn't do enough on this occasion. And I'm usually, you know, I apologise to the neighbours that we caused disruption to there. I think it is about dialogue. As you say, it's about communication, it's about early communication, and it's about giving them choices if we can. Choices to go away for the night, if that helps, or to prepare them and to listen to them. So we actually, it's not about our contractors, we have to take ownership ourselves of this matter, and I think dictate to our contractors how they deliver the work in such a way that it minimises disruption. And that's what we'll do on the platform project.
Steve? Yeah, these things obviously are a little bit like good cop, bad cop, don't you? I think I'm the good cop the most today. I just want to say thanks for the live stream delivery on time and in time. The other one that I want to go further back is the slap track development we did at Hamilton, we went through, and clearly that was a great project. We all had great fears that that wouldn't run to time or wouldn't work well. Just when things go wrong, I think it's important to learn from when things go well. And the question I'm posing is, the things that went well with Lime Street and went with the slap track, are they lessons learned and being passed around the country? And in terms of the partnership work, are we being mentioned in dispatches for our contribution as well?
Well, thank you for the question. I suppose this is the time for me to declare my vested interest, which I should have done at the start. I was the project manager for the very first phase of the slap track at Hamilton Square, which would have been about 10 or 11 years ago, I think. Time flies. So an interesting fact about that project, it wasn't such a success, actually. It was a nightmare of a job, but it was really challenging, really difficult. It was the first time that we tackled working in that subsurface environment, a very aggressive environment, for many years actually. And I remember we started the job, I think it was sometime in the early summer, May, June, whenever it was. We had about 12 or 14 days to deliver it, maybe longer. And actually after the first day, the first couple of shifts, I realised we got quite a bit out of our depth. We had 2 or 3 weeks of, it was relentless down there. It was a job. We handed the job back 12 hours late, which doesn't sound a great success, but actually we got many plaudits because I think people understood just how difficult it was. But in terms of the lessons that we learned from that, in terms of how we built the project, how we managed the logistics, and importantly how we managed communications, the second phase of work we did, which was I think the first section between James Street and Central, was a completely different project. We took everybody away to a hotel, I think somewhere near Crewe after that first phase, locked ourselves away for a couple of days, and did a thorough lessons learned study. We do lessons learned after every project that we deliver, but do we really do anything with them? On this occasion we absolutely did, and that second phase of work was delivered without sleepless nights, without stress on the teams, without the pressure, without accidents. do it well. I've always said that we have a rich history in the railway disruption in this region, but actually we managed to do it in a way that you seem to cope with it well, and I think that's because we plan it, we talk, we communicate, and we deliver some good projects. So if I could roll that out on every piece of work I deliver elsewhere in the country, then I'd do. And yes, we have learnt those lessons. And I'm always a champion for stuff we do in Liverpool. I'm always very keen to say to colleagues down south, dare I say, that actually, if you want to build a good relationship and a good way of collaborating, then go no further than Merseyside. Sometimes that surprises people. But when they come and look at what we do and how we do it, Lime Street's a great example. It speaks for itself, quite simply. Thank you.
Jerry, you bad cop.
Thank you. We have long argued for a northern route in network where it's a better aligned infrastructure, where obviously it's the majority of train services across the North America. This was accepted and assured you only from two years of the United States. What are the problems of the implementation of the maintenance timetable? Would you agree that the need for that northern route needs to be revisited? Thank you.
Thank you for that question. Again, a very pertinent question given what's happened around the May timetable. But I'm tempted to rephrase the question: would a northern route have avoided the problems that we had with the timetable? Although that probably isn't helpful, it's a difficult question to answer. I don't know is the honest answer to that. The failure of the timetable was very complicated, very complex, frankly involved a lot of influences that were off the northern route. I don't think the creation of the northern route, frankly, would have changed the way that the projects have been delivered or the challenges we would have had, for example, on the Bolton corridor. That those are always, in hindsight, going to be difficult. Do I think that would have allowed us to react any differently? I don't think so. I have no evidence of that. So it's a challenging question to answer in respect of the timetable change, because as I say, there are a whole load of reasons for that I think are different to the way we operate the business, trying to split the operation of the business and the route from the change of the timetable, those are rather different things. As things have happened, we have appointed a director for the North, and Jane Hunter has recently joined Network Rail. She will work across the region from Merseyside across to Leeds and into Yorkshire and beyond, principally to give us that oversight, that focus, and to support all of our stakeholders. But it is a difficult question to answer. I think that the problems with the timetable are far more complex than the operational, organisational structure of our business, I think is my answer to that.
Thanks, Chair. We're very concerned about the announcement of the December timetable. It means that there's no additional service improvements delivered on Northern Trans and Iron franchise. In particular terms, this means that the new Liverpool Glasgow service that was due to start in December will now not be introduced until May 2019 at the earliest. Our understanding is that this is due to Network Rail being unable to resource timetable change works. As this service is three times a day and in each direction, it's basically six segments that are required to deliver this important service. Could you revisit this in order to ensure that these services can start in December as planned? As the operator, Transpennine Express has resourced their own stock and staff in order to run them. That's part one of your question. We will answer that one first.
Okay, again, firstly, apologies I apologise early for the challenges that we have had as a business with the introduction of the May timetable. and the knock-on effect that that's had across the industry and across the network. Incredibly difficult, incredibly challenging, and very complicated. To answer your question, then, yes, I'll take that away. I'll go and ask the question. My understanding, again, is it's far more complex than at first sight. It is, yes, it's dependent on rolling stock, but it's also sort of paths across the north, the whole of the northern timetable. It's sort of predicated, particularly around the work we're doing on the Bolton corridor, which has been delayed sort of another 6 months. That will be complete, but the timetable won't come in until May. We've taken a decision as an industry to divorce the timetable from the infrastructure, and I think with hindsight that was the right thing to do. But to answer your question, I need to take that away, and I will do. I'll ask the chair to drop me a note, and I'll respond formally to it if I may.
The second part is launch the station. I understand that the statue of Bessie Braddock has been removed. Is it your organisation that's done it? And can they have a back?
Well, it's definitely not in my back garden, but although it would grace it somewhat. As far as I'm aware, it will be returning shortly. So Marcus tells me, and I'm going to hold him to that. So yes, I believe it will be coming back. We've not heard otherwise. I assume it's in some place. Good. Right. Again, I'll come back to you all and confirm that. Rest assured, it will be reappearing.
Excellent news. Natalie.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Patrick and Marcus, for your presentation. I was quite pleased to hear that network grew is not about profits, and it's about people. And congratulations for delivering Lime Street on time, 4 a.m. before the first rain starts. We're quite passionate about wanting to broaden local community and local network, that network rail serves. And my question basically is, in terms of the projects you've delivered, for instance, McGill North, Newton, Lee Willows, that's great. However, like one of my colleagues raised, we're quite disappointed that all these projects have significant costs overrun, and one has been delayed in its delivery. Can you explain the reason for each of these, and do you agree with us that network rail should fund the cost of overrun? Now, you've mentioned the insurance and in terms of the central pot. However, if from what you're saying to me, it's not about profits, it's all about people, do you agree that network rail should fund the cost of any overrun?
Okay, well, thank you. Let me start by sort of giving you an appraisal of the project. So I think it's important to note that they haven't all gone over budget and they haven't all gone beyond their schedule. So we'll start with the success story, which is the Foulkes, which was delivered on programme, actually slightly ahead of programme, and it was delivered ahead of target cost to the tune of about £1 million. So there was £1 million saving on that particular project. That saving comes back to the client, as you would expect. In terms of the other projects, the Newton Willows, that is an incredibly challenging and complex project. By trade, I'm a civil engineering project manager, although not for a few years. And when I looked at that project, quite clearly my view of that was that that's going to be difficult. It's reasonably novel what we're doing there in terms of the kind of impact that we're cutting through. It's not a station job by any means, as we would say. It's not like a McGull. It's very much a heavy civil engineering project and quite a risky one. This involves us punching through a man-made embankment that was put there over 150 years ago. So it's a difficult project, a challenging and a technically complex project. I think it's reasonable to anticipate that all may not go as planned. Projects are very dynamic things. As I say, sometimes they go incredibly well, such as on the curve, and you get some change in your pocket. Sometimes they don't, and Newton Willows is an example of that. In terms of the God station, then yeah, again, that one is within a shout of the cost, within a several hundred thousand pounds, but that's prolongation, and it's again as a consequence of us accommodating the needs of the neighbours. Now, I think the difference there is what we probably should have done is planned to do it the way we did, and we would have still incurred the cost. We would have just been able to plan for that cost. That's the difference. But I think Newley Willows is a different project. That is genuine project risk, which is materialised, which we can have to deal with. Should Network Rail pay for that? Well, firstly, as I say, we levy a risk and a fee fund contribution of all of the projects, which in this case I don't know the numbers, but I imagine those contributions are somewhat less than the delta we'll be looking at on that project relative to the cost that we anticipated at the outset and the final cost of the project. So if we can accommodate those from the fee, the risk fund, then that is the industry paying for that. Yes, you've had to contribute, but it's only like paying for your car insurance or your house insurance. It's a relative contribution given what you get back. On this case, again, a very challenging and difficult project. I guess the difference with that one is we, if we'd seen this coming, we'd be, it'd have been a £15 million project and whatever, a £12, £13 million project. So, as I say, that's why we have those risk and fee funds. They're established, have been long established by us as an industry to protect third parties such as Merseytravel against project risk, and we would intend and anticipate and will apply to draw down on those to help us fix the financial challenges that we have in the world.
Going back on that point, that's like.
Thank you, Patrick, for that. I do acknowledge from your comment that it was a technical project, and you said if you had anticipated. Going forward, obviously, you said you've worked on many projects within the Merseyside area. Do you think you can anticipate better? Because obviously, as many authorities, we don't have the funding that we would have received 10 years ago. So in terms of going forward, learning from these challenging and technical projects, do you think you'd better do the costing so therefore we don't incur any further fees?
Yeah, we learn every time we do this for a project, we learn lessons, and I talked there about the Mersey loop and the slab track and the way we learn lessons on that project. Ultimately, when we learn those lessons on that first phase of that Mersey loop project, it sent the cost of the second phase rocketing, but it was for the right reason. Actually, we delivered it to the anticipated cost that we had at the outset. So your point's absolutely right. Yes, we will learn those lessons. Yes, we will dial those lessons into any similar projects that we're asked to do. And we will be fully transparent about the numbers, and we are transparent about the numbers that we put in front of all of our customers and clients when we deliver projects. But as I say, with Newley Willows, clearly there were challenges there that neither of us anticipated would manifest themselves in quite the way they did, quite to the cost profile they did. But absolutely, we'll dial all those lessons into everything we did. And if somebody asked me to build another Newley Willows, it's at least 50 million Willows. That's what we're saying. Thank you.
Okay, a couple of ones from myself. If I'm at one a bit longer distance, then one a bit more local. Obviously, the experience of the May Tower when it first came in on Northern and Transpan was, being very diplomatic here, pretty horrific, right across the North. And obviously, Northern, obviously, Network Rail has an element of responsibility and culpability in all of that with regard to the delay in infrastructure enhancements, which then knocked out the rolling stock allocation plans for Northern, which then knocked out their trade group on proposals, and that contributed to some of the real significant problems in those first few weeks. Whilst quite a few of those bits are now being worked through, one of the things that appears to be quite sort of key at this moment in time with the fact that punctuality and reliability, both Northern and TPE, still isn't where it should be, is because of the real congestion problems on the Castle Hill corridor in the middle of Manchester. Now, obviously that's beyond our patch, but we're experiencing lots of knock-on delays because of that, to the train service that then comes into the city region. What are you doing as the infrastructure provider to try and kind of help resolve all those issues in the middle of Manchester that then span across the world?
Okay, thank you. Again, a very pertinent question. I'll answer it a couple of ways if I may. I think to give you some background, you're absolutely right in what you say around the impact of the delays to some of the critical parts of the or components of new infrastructure that we needed to deliver for the timetable and the impact that those had on the way the timetable was delivered and how the industry prepared for that. In terms of the Castlefield corridor, that is really quite complicated. We've had a very difficult summer on the Castlefield corridor, to say the least. Quite a lot of challenges. The interesting thing with the Castlefield corridor, without getting too sort of railway or technical, is the corridor performs well when you deliver services to it at the right point in time. Anything other than that, and it starts to unravel rather quickly. So conversely, although the capacity on the corridor is there, if you don't use it the way that the timetable needs you to, as you rightly point out, it starts to unravel quite quickly, and you get that perturbation and that compounded perturbation, which is difficult. We've had a difficult summer for a number of reasons, not least because of Northern's challenges with the train crew and the rolling stock, and we've also had a lot of delay off that part of the network, so we've had a very hot summer. We've had far too many lifestyle fires, which have impacted on us across the Pennines, which have stopped us getting trains to the corridor at the right point in time, and so on and so forth. So it has been really very difficult for us to manage. There are a number of things we're doing to look to resolve the Castlefield corridor. There's the short term and there's the long term. A lot of work is being done with our train planning teams, our operators and our operators' train planning teams in terms of making the current timetable resilient. Yes, indeed, that involved Northern taking quite a few services out to settle things down, but that's been slowly building up and performance has been improving certainly over the last month across the corridor. That hopefully will continue as we move into the autumn and the winter, but actually ultimately we know we have a piece of work to do with our corridor and the infrastructure there. Needs looking at. For me, I think there are two or three things we need to focus on. A, train capacity on the corridor and how we can provide resilience around that. So the Secretary of State suggested, and we're looking at a number of digital railway options around signalling and signalling paths and train paths and how that works for us. But importantly, actually, one of the key things really on the corridor is capacity at either end, so Oxford Road and Piccadilly stations. Platform 13 and 14 at Piccadilly, I think they'll probably all agree, is a pretty unsatisfactory experience. It's pretty unsatisfactory in terms of the customer experience, but it's pretty unsatisfactory in terms of the way that we get people on and off trains in a timely fashion. So we're doing a piece of work to understand what we can do there in terms of capacity enhancements to that piece of infrastructure. And potentially a new entrance to the station. The same as, it's pretty much the same at Oxford Road. Part of the scheme that we originally